program is sponsored as a public service to the citizens of this state by the North Carolina Association of Broadcasters Educational Foundation. Here's our moderator, Nora O'Donnell.
Good evening, and thank you for joining us for the first of two North Carolina Association of Broadcasters Educational Foundation Senate debates. I'm Nora O'Donnell from CBS News, and I'm delighted to be here as your moderator. First, let's introduce the candidates. To your right is Speaker Thom Tillis, the Republican candidate for the United States Senate. Speaker Tillis currently serves as the Speaker of the House in North Carolina's state legislature. Welcome, Speaker Tillis.
Thank you, Nora.
And on your left is Senator Kay Hagan. She is a Democratic candidate for the United States Senate. Senator Hagan is currently a U.S. Senator from North Carolina. Welcome to you, Senator Hagan.
Thank you, Nora.
Great to have both of you here tonight. Now, before we begin, here are the rules for the debate. We will start with opening statements. Following those, the candidates will respond to questions that have been provided by members of the state's broadcast news media, along with input from me. For the next part of the debate, the candidates will have an opportunity to ask each other questions directly. And finally, the debate will conclude with closing statements by each candidate. We want you to know that the order of the opening and closing statements and which candidate gets the first question were determined and agreed to prior to this debate by the candidates and their campaigns. Speaker Tillis will make the first opening statement and will also receive the first question. So let's begin. Speaker Tillis.
Thank you. It is time for somebody in North Carolina to cross party lines and finally get something done in this country. Voting 92% with the president, whether you agree with him or not, doesn't work here in North Carolina. Kay Hagan said that in 2008. Then Kay got elected, and she's voted with President Obama 95% of the time. By Kay's own standard, she's failed the people of North Carolina, and that's why I'm running for the U.S. Senate. I grew up understanding hard work, growing up in a family with modest means. I know what it's like raising a family, struggling to make ends meet, and going to college at night. As the Speaker of the House, I cut spending, I cut regulations, and I cleaned up some of the mess that Kay left behind in Raleigh. As your U.S. Senator, I'll go to Washington, and I won't be a rubber stamp for Barack Obama and Harry Reid. I'll go there, get things done, and make America great again. Kay promised us she'd be different, but she broke her promise. If you're tired of the rhetoric and you want results, please vote for Thom Tillis. Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker Tillis. Senator Hagan, your turn now.
Thank you, Nora. And voters, thanks for tuning in tonight. Tonight is about presenting voters with a choice on how to move our state forward. I approach this job with common sense, solving problems in how we can put our middle class first and making the economy work for everyone. But Speaker Tillis has different priorities, the wrong priorities. At every opportunity, he has fought for policies that are taking our state backwards. He's put tax cuts for millionaires and big corporations before our students, before women, before our middle class, and ultimately before our future. Tonight, you will be able to examine our true priorities. Please listen to whom we're fighting for. Speaker Tillis feels that those who have the most should get the most help. I believe that our middle class and small businesses come first, and the economy should work not just for the wealthy, but for everyone.
Thank you, Senator Hagan. The first question goes to Speaker Tillis. Speaker Tillis, just yesterday, a new video surfaced of a second American being executed by ISIS, otherwise known as the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. This morning, while overseas, the president vowed to degrade and destroy the terrorist group. He has already authorized airstrikes in Iraq. The focus is now on Syria. How do you think the administration should proceed? Does the U.S. need to strike ISIS in Syria to protect American national security?
Well, first, we have to go back and realize that just months ago, this president, President Obama, was calling ISIS the JV. Last week, he was referring, after the beheading of the first journalist, he came and expressed regret. And then a few days later, he said, we don't have a strategy for ISIS. Why, how on earth can you not have a strategy for an organization that's almost 10 years old? They have their roots in Syria. They've decamped some of them. They've gone to Iraq. They're actually taking over a country that men and women of the armed forces of the United States fought for and held ground. And now we're seeing a backward trend. This is an example of where President Obama has failed the people of this country, and Kay Hagan has allowed it to happen or has been silent with his inaction. We've got to have results there. We've got to make this country and this world safer. And today it's less safe than when Kay entered office in 2008.
So just to follow, Speaker, should the U.S. strike ISIS in Syria?
I think that the U.S. needs to take all actions to protect American citizens and protect freedom-loving people all over the country. I think that the president is, to a certain extent now, trying to solve a problem that his inaction created. So I think that the president, who's responsible for a foreign policy that he's failed on in a variety of places around the United States, needs to start acting and showing some leadership. And I think that Senator Hagan needs to demand that he do, particularly in a state that has one of the largest military presences in the United States.
Senator Hagan, same question to you. Does the U.S. need to strike ISIS in Syria to protect America's national security?
You know, I think one of the issues here is that the president should have weaponized the moderate Syrian rebels earlier. Without doing that, that has allowed ISIS to grow. And I believe that ISIS is the most serious threat to our national security since 9/11. I have never seen a more evil terrorist group than this entity. The fact that they have just recently beheaded the second American journalist, this is a direct attack on the United States. Time is up. Action must be taken. The president needs to bring a resolution. He needs to bring a plan to Congress. And I am at the point where, yes, I want him to do that. I want to look at it, and I want to take action.
So you do believe that there should be strikes
yes.
in Syria?
I believe we need to work with the moderate Syrian rebels. I think the fact that we have the most capable air surveillance groups in the country, this is an issue that's really a threat not just to Syria, but to Iraq. Look at what's going on in Iraq right now with this caliphate that ISIS has put forward. We need to work with our allies, and being the strongest military in the world, I want to see the president's plan, and I'm ready to take action.
Mm-hmm. Speaker Tillis, would you like to reply?
Yeah, I think that it's extraordinary that Senator Hagan says now that ISIS is one of the greatest threats globally, and we have a president that doesn't have a strategy for it. We've seen the beheadings of two Americans over the last couple of weeks. The president announced his regret for the beheading and then went and played a round of golf. And a couple of days later, he said that they don't have a strategy. The American people deserve better than that, and Kay Hagan should be pounding the table for this president versus rubber stamping a failed policy that's not working.
Senator Hagan, you also get a reply.
Thank you, Nora. I have said that I think one of the faults is that the president didn't arm the moderate Syrian rebels earlier in order to prevent ISIS from having the ability to grow and to recruit, to use their social media at the extent that they're doing. They are the most serious terrorist threat facing the country today. We need to take action. As I said, time is up, but the president does need to bring a plan. And I am ready to support. At first, I've got to obviously see what it is, but I am ready to support and do what needs to be done to take ISIS out.
Senator Hagan, thank you. The next question goes to you. Healthcare has been a big topic in this Senate race. The Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, is currently the law of the land, and the problems with its implementation have been well documented. Senator Hagan, you voted for it. Speaker Tillis, you have said you want to repeal it. If reelected, what would you do to improve the quality of health care North Carolinians receive?
You know, thank you, Nora. I talk to people all across North Carolina, and they tell me they don't want to go back to the broken system. They want us to fix and improve this law, and that is exactly what I am doing. But when I look at what Speaker Tillis does, he wants to repeal this law. He would take us back to that broken system when seniors would pay more for their coverage than men. Women would pay more. Seniors would pay more than they're paying today. Their prescriptions would be much more. And if you had a pre-existing condition, forget about the availability of health care. That is not what our seniors want or the American people. The other thing that Speaker Tillis would support, he supports a budget that would turn Medicare into a voucher program. And seniors, this would mean financial insecurity, higher out-of-pocket cost. And it would just certainly take our seniors back. Medicare turning it into a voucher program is not good for our seniors. I think Speaker Tillis doesn't understand the needs of North Carolinians nor the American people.
Speaker Tillis, same question. What would you do to improve the quality of health care that North Carolinians receive?
I wouldn't cast the deciding vote for the single largest tax increase or one of the largest tax increases in American history. I wouldn't pass Obamacare, which is going to bankrupt this country, and fail to fulfill the promises that they've made. And Kay knows a little bit about making promises that are not going to be fulfilled. On 24 different occasions, when Kay was trying to defend her vote on Obamacare, she said, if you like your doctor, you can keep it. She said, if you like your health care, you can keep it. 475,000 policy cancellation notices have come across this state. People aren't able to keep their health care. I'm wondering at what point in time or if Kay still believes that she's keeping the promise that she made. And it's not only there. Obamacare only gets the books balanced or makes the debt less worse by taking $700 billion away from Medicare to pay for it. It's just financially flawed and it's not sustainable and it will not fulfill the promises. The promises have already been broken and they're going to be worse as we go forward. And it's going to have an effect on Medicare and Medicaid and other entitlements that are important to fulfill our promises, particularly to seniors.
Senator Hagan, would you like to reply where, and specifically the charge when you said you can keep it?
Certainly, Nora. Some insurance companies were not being upfront with their consumers. But as soon as this came to my attention last fall, I immediately sponsored legislation allowing those plans to become permanent. And that is what took place in North Carolina. I think what we need to look at here is the fact that Speaker Tillis has denied Medicaid expansion in North Carolina. That's 500,000 people that could get coverage. These people still get sick. They go to the emergency room where they're really getting just episodic treatment, and it's the most expensive care there is. Just today in the newspaper in Greenville, North Carolina, they were talking about how ECU and Vidant are having unbelievable problems because of no Medicaid expansion. We've already had one hospital close in Belhaven. Speaker Tillis is proud of the fact that he hasn't expanded Medicaid.
Thank you, Senator. Just a reminder for everyone to keep to the time. And Speaker Tillis, you are also granted a reply. Would you like to reply to the charge about denying Medicaid expansion?
Well, I want to go back to the more fundamental problem. Kay Hagan has failed the people of North Carolina by promising them something that she can't deliver. I want the best health care in the world. We already have it. Why are we destabilizing 250 million Americans who are satisfied with their insurance? Kay Hagan has basically said that the government determined, even though you were satisfied with your health care, she determined it was insufficient, and that's why 475,000 households have received cancellation notices.
All right, the next question goes to Speaker Tillis. Education funding and teacher pay is a big issue in this campaign. Voters in this state have no doubt seen many of the television ads. Both of you have stressed the importance of recruiting and retaining qualified and effective teachers. In your view, what is the best way to do that?
Well, first, I think we have to recognize that we passed this year one of the largest pay increases for teachers in the last generation. We were able to do that because of the hard decisions we made when we came in to clean up a lot of the mess that Kay Hagan left behind when she went from Raleigh to Washington. I was a PTA president just 8 years ago. I wasn't in politics. I volunteered in public school all the time my kids were going to school. What teachers tell me is they want the freedom to teach the kids. They don't want Washington bureaucrats, who on average make $102,000 a year, 5,000 of them, telling teachers how to teach in schools. They're forcing tests, they're forcing reports, they're taking freedom out of the classroom, they're preventing teachers from being able to innovate. We need to pay our teachers top salaries, and we're working on that. We've done more in this session than's been done in years. We need to add to that, but we also need to get the federal government out of the way and stop having them force decisions on these teachers. They know how to educate our children. I know these teachers. They're great people. They want to do that for our kids. We should let them do it.
Senator Hagan, your view on the best way to keep good teachers?
We need to respect our teachers and we need to pay them. We have seen an exodus of teachers in North Carolina under Speaker Tillis's tenure. In North Carolina, education has always been a bipartisan priority. I wrote state budgets for 6 years. We invested in education every year. During my 6 years, teachers got a 21% pay raise. Every child, every parent knows the value of a great teacher, except Speaker Tillis. Let me tell you what he said. He said that teachers don't care about their kids, they don't care about their classrooms. All they care about are their jobs and their pensions. Folks, those are his words, not mine. And his priorities even speak louder than his words. The fact that he gave tax cuts to the millionaires, he cut education by $500 million. That means fewer teachers in the classroom, larger class sizes, and outdated textbooks. I think Speaker Tillis needs to revamp his education budget.
Speaker Tillis, you get a reply.
Two numbers. 7 and 10. 7% pay raise for teachers in North Carolina, making us regionally competitive and nationally competitive. 10, the number of years that Kay Hagan served in the legislature, and she allowed the kinds of tax breaks that she's talking about to be on the books. And instead of repealing them, she decided when times got rough that she would impose a temporary tax increase, sales tax increase, that harms the poor and working class more than anyone else. She went further and broke her promise. She said it was going to be temporary. She made some of it permanent. I fulfilled her promise when I repealed that sales tax and when I became speaker in 2011.
Senator Hagan, you also get a reply.
Nora, we're throwing some numbers out here. Let me throw out the number 48. North Carolina is 48th in the nation in what we spend per pupil. Unbelievable. And Speaker Tillis is bragging about that. You know, for a teacher who's been in the system for many, many years, his 7% raise is a 0.3% raise. We need to do better by our teachers, by our students, by our parents, and by our state. You know, education is sacred in our state. We didn't become the state where the weak grow strong and the strong grow great by gutting public education.
The next question goes to Senator Hagan. For several years, Congress has talked about fixing the immigration system in this country. President Obama is said to be considering executive action that would slow deportations and allow more undocumented immigrants to stay in the country. First, what do you think of that approach? And second, should the president be able to take such executive action?
You know, Nora, I've actually said that the president should not take that executive action, that that should be a congressional decision. But immigration is broken in our country, and inaction is not an option. I talked to farmers, the Farm Bureau, business leaders, the Chamber of Commerce, and they all wanted to work together to support a common sense bipartisan immigration reform bill, which is exactly what I did. I have a feeling Speaker Tillis is going to talk about border security issues tonight. This bill that we passed that was bipartisan has double the number of border security agents. It makes a 700-mile-long fence on the Mexican-U.S. border. It enforces the border, enforces security. And this was a comprehensive bill worked with Democrats and Republicans. Senator Rubio, Senator McCain, Senator Graham from South Carolina all supported this bill. Speaker Tillis has no plan to solve our immigration system.
And Speaker Tillis, same question to you. Should the president be able to take this executive action?
You know, the president right now considers the three branches of government to be the executive branch, his pen, and his phone. He's completely disregarded the legislative process and the legislative branch in this discussion, and he has failed to address the immigration problem. And as a matter of fact, the immigration problem has been a bipartisan failure. For years, presidents and congressional members have talked about sealing the border, not allowing amnesty. I don't know where Senator Hagan is on amnesty. It appears as though the president's prepared to grant amnesty. I think that's a colossal mistake. Now, we talk about how easy it is to seal the border, but we're not sealing the border. We've failed to seal the border dating all the way back to the Reagan era. We need to get serious about that. A strong nation needs a strong border. We have to seal the border. Then we have to solve the other problems that exist as a result of the inaction. And Kay Hagan in 2008 saying she was going to go work to solve immigration, and all they got is a bill that went nowhere.
Mm-hmm. Senator Hagan, your reply.
You know, folks, I think Speaker Tillis is complaining, but he has no plan. This bill is a common sense immigration reform bill. As I said, there will be 40,000 border security agents, a 700-mile long fence, using electronic surveillance to follow people with their visas to be sure they leave the country when they're supposed to. And this bill is not amnesty. And as I said, it is bipartisan in nature. It is time for the House in Congress to take this legislation up.
Speaker Tillis, you also get a reply.
Yeah, you know, there's a difference between what you say and what you do. Senator Hagan said that she wanted to direct the president not to act unilaterally. Yet when Republicans tried to pass an amendment that would have forced the president to do just that, she voted against it. So, you know, leadership is something you do. It's not something you say. You can talk about sealing the border. You can talk about passing bills. But if you get nothing done, Kay Hagan has not authored a bill in 6 years that's gone to the president's desk. We need somebody who's going to commit to getting things done and get it done.
All right, the next question goes to Speaker Tillis. This summer, the Supreme Court said Hobby Lobby, a family-owned craft store, could opt out of providing contraceptive coverage to employees because of their religious objection. Do you agree or disagree with this ruling? Should all businesses be required to provide contraceptive coverage regardless of their religious beliefs?
Well, first, I believe that contraception should be available probably more broadly than it is today. I'll come back to that. The Hobby Lobby decision was not about contraception. It was about if a private business decides to open business, they haven't suddenly given up their right to religious freedom. But let's get back to the contraception issue. I actually agree with the American Medical Association that we should make contraception more widely available. I think over-the-counter oral contraception should be available without a prescription. If you do those kinds of things, you will actually increase the access and reduce the barriers for having more options for women for contraception. Kay Hagan, I suspect, with the support that she's getting from the pharmaceutical industry, may have a variety of reasons not to take it from behind the counter and put it on the counter. But I think that's something we should work together on, because that's how you improve access and reduce cost.
Senator Hagan, same question. Should all businesses be required to provide contraceptive coverage regardless of religious beliefs?
You know, I disagree with the Hobby Lobby decision. Speaker Tillis agrees with it. It does allow employers to deny access to birth control for their female employees. You know, when women's best interests are on the line, I will never back down. I support equal pay for equal work. I didn't raise my two daughters to think they were worth 82 cents on the dollar. Speaker Tillis killed an equal pay bill. He doesn't understand the needs of women. And I have always stood up for access to women's health care. Speaker Tillis doesn't. I support employers being able to give access to birth control for their employees. You know, Speaker Tillis has defunded Planned Parenthood. The only state I know of that's actually done that. I tell you, when I look at Speaker Tillis's record on women, it is abysmal. I will never back down supporting women, and I will fight for them, and he will not.
Speaker Tillis, would you like to reply?
Yeah, you know, I think we get back to religious freedom is a very important, it's a bedrock principle that this nation was built on. And Kay Hagan, this is not the only area where Kay necessarily disagrees with what the founding fathers thought were very important part of founding this nation. Look, we need to separate the two issues. When we're talking about taxpayer funding for contraception, that's different than access. And I think the Senator Hagan's trying to distort the two. The reality is, I would like Kay Hagan to consider making a commitment to let's find ways to broaden access and lower the cost of contraception. It's something that can be done, and it'll benefit the very women that she pretends or suggests that she's trying to advocate for.
Senator Hagan.
You know, once again, Speaker Tillis doesn't understand the needs of women. Prescription drugs include birth control. What he has done, he is denying women the right that other women have in order to access birth control through their company's employer-sponsored prescription drug plan. He is singling out certain employees, and I think that's indiscriminate. I think that's unconstitutional, and I totally disagree with Speaker Tillis's issue. I really think he's out of touch with women and doesn't understand their needs.
The next question goes to Senator Hagan. North Carolina is home to 770,000 military veterans and 115,000 active duty service members. President Obama and Veterans Affairs Secretary McDonald visited Charlotte last week to address the American Legion about mismanagement and delayed care at VA facilities, including getting veterans off wait lists and making referrals to private sector care. In your view, what else needs to be done?
You know, Nora, North Carolina is the most military-friendly state in the nation, and I come from a strong military family. My husband's a Vietnam veteran. My dad and brother were in the Navy. My father-in-law was a major general in the Marine Corps, and I have two nephews on active duty. One's a fighter jet pilot, the other's a Navy SEAL. I take these issues seriously and personally. You know, our veterans have put their lives at risk to support us. Their lives should not be at risk when they come home. I have demanded better from the president, and I have demanded the fact that we need to support our VA. I'm pleased we passed the VA accountability bill. But when I saw secret waiting list backlogs up to the ceiling, I took direct action. I worked in Winston-Salem to help solve that issue. But I've gotten direct action for Fayetteville, North Carolina. They have 9,000 more veterans. They need at least hold space. I have gotten that taken care of and gotten it done.
Speaker Tillis, same question. What else needs to be done?
Well, you know, in 2008, Kay stood at a podium very similar to this, and she said the VA has problems. It needs to be fixed. For 5.5 years, Kay Hagan's been in Washington. I haven't heard her pounding the table with Barack Obama and the Veterans Administration to fix the problem. The problem's gotten worse. And what's unfortunate, in the state that has one of the largest military institutions in the United States, or military presences, we're having some of the worst problems. Wait times, waiting lists. You know, these men and women swore an oath to protect us and lay down their lives for our freedom. And to come in here and say, I solved a problem in Fayetteville, or I answered a phone call here, when the fundamental problem, Kay Hagan knew it was broke in 2008. She's failed to fix it, and she's failed our veterans in North Carolina as a result. We need strong leadership, and we need to hold this president and the administration accountable for their failure.
Senator Hagan.
Let's talk about results. Jerry Ensminger was a Marine stationed at Camp Lejeune. His daughter, Janie, died of leukemia based on contaminated toxic water. From the first day I was in office, I worked with Jerry to help find answers and care for the victims. With Senator Burr, we passed the bipartisan Janie Ensminger bill, which is allowing health care for the families of victims at Camp Lejeune. Those are direct results, and I support our veterans, and they know it.
Speaker Tillis.
Well, I think in that case, Kay may have done her job, but in so many other instances, she's failed to do her job in protecting veterans and providing proper health care to these veterans. Ladies and gentlemen, we owe a debt of gratitude to their service. We need to take care of them, and we need to move heaven and earth, not for one or two cases, but for the hundreds of cases that we're hearing about from the Inspector General. You know, this is just unacceptable. It was unacceptable in 2008 when Kay said she was going to go to Washington and fix it. It's unacceptable in 2014 when the problem's gotten worse.
All right, the next question goes to Speaker Tillis. In April, the U.S. Senate voted against moving forward with a bill that would have gradually increased the federal minimum wage to $10.10 an hour. Since then, some states have taken matters into their own hands and raised the minimum wage. Right now, North Carolina's minimum wage is at the same as the federal wage, $7.25 an hour. Is that enough for the workers of North Carolina?
Well, you said something that's very important. Other states have taken action, and this is something that I believe is best left to the states versus another regulatory overreach, which Kay Hagan is very satisfied to do. She's done it with Obamacare. She's done it by supporting the EPA regulations. It's going to add $1,200 a year in related costs because of energy prices going up. You know, I talked to a business owner just 2 weeks ago, last week actually, in Western North Carolina, and he said that if we're not careful between the regulatory overreach and these other burdens being placed on small businesses, he's going to go out of business. He's a business that right now has only made a profit 2 months out of the last 12 months. These things, we need to understand the job-killing consequences of these sorts of policies. That it is not something that Kay Hagan, going to Washington should agree with Washington politicians about how we actually deal with that issue in North Carolina. I trust the citizens of North Carolina and the businesses to make that decision.
Mr. Speaker, just to follow up on the question, is $7.25 enough?
Well, you know what? If Kay Hagan has her way and the cost of health care goes up 11%, and if Kay Hagan has her way and the EPA increases energy costs by $1,200 a year, and if Kay Hagan has her way and allow these other regulatory burdens, that not only would that be enough, but 10 or 20 or 30 or 50% wouldn't be enough. The costs are going up, and the problem with this is we're creating this mindset that we have a minimum wage economy. I mean, that most people are going to be on minimum wage. I want to create an economy where minimum wage is a very brief stepping stone to higher paying jobs so people can realize their dreams.
Senator Hagan, same question to you about is $7.25 an hour enough for workers in North Carolina?
You know, I support increasing the minimum wage, which Speaker Tillis had a really hard time trying to defend that he doesn't. You know, jobs and making the economy work for everyone, especially the middle class, is my number one priority. And I do support increasing the minimum wage. Speaker Tillis said doing that is a dangerous idea. And, these are his words again, we shouldn't even have a federal minimum wage. He said that workers in Western North Carolina shouldn't earn the same federal minimum wage as workers in Boston. Once again, you know, that's what he said. And, you know, I think the best way to grow the economy and to have good jobs is a good education, is a sound education. And look again at what Speaker Tillis has done in our great state of North Carolina. He has given tax cuts to the wealthy, and he is paying for it by gutting education. $500 million from our education system. And teachers, as I said, are leaving in droves. Speaker Tillis has the wrong priorities for jobs and the economy.
Speaker Tillis.
You know, I grew up and I worked for minimum wage for several years. What I want from government is for it to get out of my way so I can realize my dreams. What Kay Hagan wants from government is to give you or to provide you this sense that there's nothing more than minimum wage. Who in this country, what leader would settle for an economy that's based on the minimum wage? It's a stepping stone that through education and hard work, you should get past very quickly. Senator Hagan doesn't understand, though, that the ultimate decision about the minimum wage in this state needs to rest in this state. Don't turn your back on the state, Kay. Let the folks down here decide what's right for North Carolina.
Senator Hagan, a reply.
Well, obviously, Speaker Tillis hasn't done anything in this regard, so obviously he's okay with the $7.25 minimum wage. But once again, I talk to business leaders all the time, and they are concerned about jobs in North Carolina because of what Speaker Tillis has done to our education system. They're worried about teachers not being paid. They're worried about teachers leaving. They're worried about students not coming into the College of Education system where they can be educated to become teachers. The most important thing for business and the economy is a sound education, and Speaker Tillis is taking us back.
Next question goes to Senator Hagan. Here in North Carolina, the unemployment rate is 6.5%, but if you take into account those who have stopped looking for work, it's more like 13%. As of July, North Carolina offers the fewest weeks of unemployment benefits of any state in the nation. Speaker Tillis, you've dealt with this issue at a state level, and Senator Hagan, you've dealt with it at a federal level. What is the best solution to support the long-term unemployed?
Certainly not what Speaker Tillis has done in North Carolina. We were the only state in the nation under his leadership that changed the unemployment insurance formula. So 170,000 people in North Carolina became ineligible to receive federal unemployment benefits. You know, folks, he actually said no to $780 million that would have come in to North Carolina, helped our rural economies, helped the unemployed. But because he favored helping the business community, he was unable to do that. Once again, one of the best ways we can work on creating jobs and growing this economy is being sure we have a fair and more simpler tax system, which I'm certainly working on in Congress, and to have a good education system. Every CEO that comes into my office in Washington says the best thing that we have in North Carolina is the great work ethic of our people, but they're worried about education.
Speaker Tillis, your response.
Well, I tell you, Kay's answer leads me to believe she hadn't been in North Carolina lately. We did make the difficult decision to not extend the unemployment benefits, long-term unemployment benefits. And you know what the consequence of that was? To go from 10.5%, 10.4% unemployment to 6.5%. We're putting people back to work. We're giving them the opportunity to be free of government dependence. We're giving them the motivation to go to school, get greater skills, get off minimum wage, and actually enjoy the fruits of their labor. Kay, in the prior question, said that she supports business. She's talked to businesses. The businesses now, as a result of that tough decision, and it's tough when you're a leader and you actually do what you say you're going to do, but we did it, and we reduced a $2.7 billion debt to the federal government. Next year, it's going to be paid off. The cost of businesses are going to go down, and even more people are going to be employed. It's why we've got some of the best job creation numbers in the Southeast, and it's why we've got one of the fastest growing economies after years of stagnation under Kay's leadership.
Senator Hagan.
You know, Speaker Tillis, by doing the tax cuts for the wealthy, you have really put the burden on everybody else. The earned income tax cut, that helped 64,000 military families in our state. When I'm talking about a sound education, Speaker Tillis did away with a college savings tax plan that helps families save for college. He even added a sales tax to a college student's meal plan, once again hurting that individual that is trying so hard to get a degree so they can move forward. Speaker Tillis continuously has the wrong priorities.
Speaker Tillis.
Well, you know, 7%. A 7% pay raise, one of the largest pay raises in a generation. That's reality, and that's math, and that's something that Kay needs to accept. 10 years, these tax cuts for the rich that Kay's talking about are largely the things that she's using in her ads attacking me. As a matter of fact, Kay's ads have gotten so negative, she's really attacking herself. She's attacking a policy that she supported as a state senator. And then it was Kay, not Thom Tillis, who raised taxes on the poor by imposing a sales tax, promising to make it temporary, and then making it permanent. Another broken promise.
The next question goes to Speaker Tillis. In the wake of the unrest in Ferguson, Missouri, following the shooting death of an unarmed African-American teenager by a white officer, there's been a discussion over whether police departments have become too militarized because of a Pentagon program that provides surplus military equipment to law enforcement. North Carolina has received thousands of pieces of military equipment, armored vehicles, assault rifles, and others. In your view, do you see this so-called militarization of the police as a problem? Should the program continue?
Well, first, I think we all need to recognize that the tragedy in Ferguson was a tragedy regardless of the circumstances. It's a tragedy for all the families involved and for the community, and my heart goes out to them. We also need to take a look at these first responders, and particularly police officers. Like our men and women in uniform and military, every day they wake up willing to fulfill an oath that they will lay down their lives to protect someone else. I'm going to leave it to police officers, rank and file members, the municipalities determine the best way that you can keep the peace, but keep these law enforcement officers safe. I mean, we owe it to them to make sure that they're protected. I'm not going to rethink what's necessary to do that, but what I do know is we owe the police officers across the United States a debt of gratitude for what they do every single day.
Senator Hagan, same question. Should the program continue?
You know, I certainly support our police. I support our sheriffs. I support all of our first responders. But I think this issue of militarization of our police has gone a step too far, and we definitely need to be looking at that program. I also know that in many communities, especially here in North Carolina, we have great citizens, great communities that work together. In Guilford County, the NCCJ, the National Conference for Communities and Justice, brings together and they dialogue to help solve these kinds of problems before they get started. But Nora, I want to go back to Speaker Tillis's earlier comment, and this has to do with math. I'm actually insulted by his comments. I was a vice president at a bank. I wrote billion-dollar state budgets in the state of North Carolina. I understand math. Even when I was a teenager, I worked at my dad's tire store and did layaway for people buying tires. I understand math. But what I really value are our math teachers in this state, and Speaker Tillis doesn't.
Do you want to reply to that?
Yeah, well, we'll get right back to the math. In 2008, Senator Hagan echoed President Obama's comments that a $10 trillion debt was a national disgrace. Then Kay Hagan went to Washington. She rubber-stamped Barack Obama's failed policies, and now our debt's at $17 trillion. That's simple math. It's going to the point to where it is stifling growth. It's a debt that is dragging down the economy. And I might add, if it continues, it's going to harm the teachers and other folks that we need to pay to do the very important jobs that they're doing.
Senator Hagan, you also get a reply.
I think Speaker Tillis has done such damage in North Carolina from his failed policies, from his favoring tax cuts to the wealthy, gutting our education system, having to pay for that by doing away with the earned income tax credit, helping the unemployed in North Carolina, all of these other burdens that are now being put on the middle class. I think that's wrong. And I think the fact he didn't expand Medicaid, that is going to have one of the most disastrous consequences on this state because of his actions.
We have now reached the portion of the debate where the candidates will have an opportunity to ask each other questions. And the candidate asking the question will also have a chance to respond. It has been agreed upon that Speaker Tillis will receive the first candidate question. Senator Hagan.
Thank you, Nora. My question is about education. Speaker Tillis, please explain to the people of North Carolina why your budget cut $500 million from education spending in order to give a tax cut to the wealthy.
Well, you know, Kay, if you actually read the budget, and I assume that when you were in the legislature you did, you haven't read ours. We've got a 7% pay increase, which is one of the largest pay increases to teachers in the last 20 years. We've actually reduced classroom sizes as a result of our proposal by about one student. It's not enough, but it's progress. But here's something that you should know a lot about being a senior appropriations chair, Kay. When I have a bill that I personally was responsible for helping move through the House, we had 117-0 vote. Every single Democrat in the House chamber voted for an appropriations measure that sent a very clear message to teachers in North Carolina: you're our priority. We made absolutely certain when we had a respectful disagreement with the Senate that we were standing firm on maintaining classroom funding. I'm proud of what we've done, and Kay's math just doesn't add up.
Senator Hagan, you get to reply.
You know, I think people in North Carolina would find that incredulous. All the cuts that have been to our education system are harming the system. I think you ought to respond on why teachers are leaving in droves. In Wake County, 650 teachers had left by March. That's a 44% increase from before. We've got the former superintendent in Houston coming to North Carolina and be very successful recruiting our teachers. But listening to your comment about the budget, I do want to say that, Speaker Tillis, you don't understand my record in Congress. I have gotten things done. My America Works jobs training bill passed. My Camp Lejeune water contamination bill passed. My tuition assistance benefit for our military passed. All of these bills were bipartisan. I worked with Republicans to get them done, and that is effective legislation.
Speaker Tillis, you also get a reply.
Well, you know, I just think again that that Senator Hagan really needs to understand and maybe spend some more time back in the state, understanding the great things that we've done in this state. By making the difficult decisions in 2011, we were able to provide the single largest pay increase for teachers in 20 years. It's a fact, an average of 7%. We're working on classroom funding, but the problem remains that Kay Hagan's consent and support for the Department of Education's overreach is taking money out of the classrooms and giving it to bureaucrats that make $102,000 a year.
Speaker Tillis, you now have the next question for Senator Hagan.
Senator Hagan, in 2008, you said someone who votes with the president 92% of the time doesn't work here in North Carolina. And yet, since you've been in Washington, you voted with President Obama 95% of the time. Do you believe that President Obama has done great things for North Carolina? And do you support what he's done for the citizens of the North Carolina?
You know, folks, Speaker Tillis is certainly misleading you about my record, and he's certainly misleading you about his record, too. I'm going to jump back to the other question. His 7% raise, if you were a senior teacher, meaning over 20, 25 years, you would get a 0.3%. He's done away with longevity scales. Even the individual in the Department of Education in the state of North Carolina said that the way you have calculated these issues has changed the first time since 1933, and it's the worst thing that they've ever seen in North Carolina. Now let me talk to you about what you're saying about the president. I want people to know I am the most moderate senator in the nation. The nonpartisan National Journal has ranked me that because of my ability to work across the aisle and get things done. You know, I stand with the president when it's right for North Carolina, but let me tell you, I stand with the people of North Carolina when it's right for the people of North Carolina. And I voted against the president and my party. Trade deals sent too many manufacturing jobs overseas. I've told the president we need to build the Keystone Pipeline.
Speaker Tillis.
Kay Hagan's voted with President Obama 95% of the time. She promised us she'd be different, and she's broken the promise. And she didn't answer the question. I think the real answer is she probably regrets the fact that she's been a rubber stamp for Harry Reid and Barack Obama. You can't vote 95% of the time with President Obama and not say and say you're moderate or independent. The only instance of independence that I've seen in Kay Hagan over the last 6 years is independence from the citizens of North Carolina. She seems like she's gone to Washington to represent their interest and not our interest. Kay Hagan has failed the people of North Carolina because she's missed the fact that it matters to be here. It matters to talk to those businesses. It matters to provide a historic pay raise. These are things that Kay Hagan needs to come back home and see the great things that we've been doing in North Carolina since she's gone to Washington.
Senator Hagan, would you like to address that charge that you voted with the president 95% of the time?
Certainly, Nora. I have stood up to the president and my party when it's right for North Carolina. As I said, I voted against trade deals that sent too many North Carolina manufacturing jobs overseas. I've told the president we need to build the Keystone Pipeline. I've voted against my own party's budget when there were too deep of cuts to our military. I have stood up for the people of North Carolina. I've held a town hall meeting in every 100 counties in North Carolina. I know the people of North Carolina, and I support them, I represent them, and I am their voice in the Senate.
Senator Hagan, your next question now for Speaker Tillis.
Speaker Tillis, you have consistently made it more difficult for women to access birth control. You defunded Planned Parenthood and have said that employers should be able to deny coverage of birth control. Speaker Tillis, it's 2014. Why have you worked to make birth control so inaccessible?
Senator Hagan, you may not have been paying attention in the earlier question, but what I said is we need to provide broader access and work to lower the cost of contraception. That's what I said. As a matter of fact, maybe we should talk about the extent to which you could separate yourself from big pharmaceutical companies who are clearly supporting your campaign and start talking about providing lower cost alternatives and a broader access through over-the-counter oral contraceptives. The American Medical Association has said that they're safe, they're effective, and they should be allowed to be provided. We all know that when you provide broader access, that prices go down. This is the way that you actually increase access and provide more women more opportunities and more choices.
Senator Hagan.
Thank you, Nora. You know, I think once again, Speaker Tillis just doesn't understand the needs of women. The fact that he supports the Hobby Lobby decision that does allow an employer to deny access to birth control for their employees. You know, I would certainly support over-the-counter contraceptive, but I want it to be part of the prescription drug plan if these individuals are working for a for-profit company. That's what Speaker Tillis would deny. Once again, women, we're stuck holding the bill. We would have to pay out of pocket, which all the other situations would not. I think Speaker Tillis has the wrong priorities.
Speaker Tillis, would you like to reply to that, how you would allow broader access to contraceptive coverage?
Well, it was fascinating because if you weren't paying attention, you may not have heard it. But what Kay did there is what she's done on Obamacare. On the one hand, she said she supports broad access over the counter. On the other hand, she said it needs to be rolled into a prescription drug program. That seems to be saying one thing and doing another, and that's not new to Kay. I mean, take a look at Kay of 2008 and take a look at Kay of 2014. Kay 1.0, Kay 2.0. You know, at the end of the day, we need to say what we mean and then we need to execute, and I don't think Kay has. She's failed the citizens of North Carolina on this and many other scores.
Now to our last candidate question, Speaker Tillis, your question to Senator Hagan.
Yeah, Senator Hagan, when you were out selling Obamacare, you went before the public on 24 different occasions, and you said, if you like your health care, you can keep it. In some cases, you said, if you like your doctor, you can keep it. But now we all know that that wasn't true. My question to you is, that was a promise made to the citizens of North Carolina. At what point did you realize it wasn't true? And why didn't you explain yourself at that point?
Speaker Tillis, you must not be paying attention. As I said earlier, some insurance companies were not being upfront with their consumers. As soon as I found that out last fall, I took action. I sponsored legislation to allow those plans to be made permanent. And Speaker Tillis, if you were really following what's happening in North Carolina, you would know that people in North Carolina are allowed to keep those plans. But what I think people in North Carolina really need to understand is that Speaker Tillis would take us back to a broken system. He would take us back to a time when seniors paid more for prescription coverage than they do today. Women, once again, would automatically pay more for their coverage than men. And if you had a pre-existing condition, forget about the availability of health insurance. Speaker Tillis also would reopen the donut hole. He supports a budget that would turn Medicare into a voucher program, which would mean financial insecurity for our seniors. Speaker Tillis wants to take us back to a broken system.
Speaker Tillis, do you want to address that charge?
Yeah,
you want to take people back?
Senator Hagan probably knows that 85% of all health care decisions made in households are made by women. Now, Senator Hagan needs to talk to these women and explain why the government has determined a health care policy that they were satisfied with is no longer fits the bill, and that justifies her broken promise. That's what she said. I mean, you need to see what's happening here tonight. We're justifying someone who broke a promise to the citizens of North Carolina. If I like my health care, why do I care what Kay Hagan thinks about it? If I'm satisfied with it, if it's serving my family's needs, the women who opened up 475,000 cancellation notices are wondering why. I was happy with it. Now I'm not sure if I can keep my same doctor. Now I know my policy's going to change. And incidentally, in September and October, you're going to see your insurance rates go up by 11% because Kay knows best. I don't believe that. I believe you know best.
Senator Hagan, you get to reply.
You know, once again, Speaker Tillis would turn seniors' Medicare into a voucher program, financial insecurity. Speaker Tillis denied access to Medicaid coverage for 500,000 people in this state. It is having a destabilizing condition, especially in our rural communities. People need help. And the fact that Speaker Tillis said no, the problem is that is going to increase cost. These people still get sick. They will go to the emergency room. That's where everybody's cost will increase.
All right, thank you. And with that, we have concluded the candidate question part of the debate. Now we are going to ask each candidate to take 90 seconds for closing statements. And we'll begin with Senator Hagan.
Thank you, Nora. And voters, thanks again for tuning in. You know, I want to give a story. I want to tell a story about results that I've taken. I heard from our men and women in duty at Fort Bragg that they were going to lose a tuition assistance benefit that allowed them to take one college class a semester. They found out due to sequestration that they would be denied this. I immediately got to work on this problem, and I worked with Republican Senator Jim Inhofe from Oklahoma. Within 2 weeks, we had an amendment that was on the Senate floor passed. It passed the House, and it was signed into law by the president within 2 weeks. It shows, once again, that I am the most moderate senator, that I can work across the aisle and get things done, get results for the people of North Carolina. The most amazing thing, I landed that weekend coming home from Washington back to North Carolina, and I had more mothers and more wives who came up to me at the airport, sought me out and said, Senator Hagan, we were so worried about how, one woman said, Senator Hagan, I am so worried about how my son was going to finish his college degree. Thank you. Do you know, folks, over 50,000 men and women have gotten their college degree under this program. And I know how important it is because I know how important education is. I worked across the aisle, got something done, and I am proud of that. Voters, I ask for your support so I can continue representing you, putting the middle class first and making the economy work for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Hagan. Speaker Tillis, your closing statement.
Well, Nora, I want to thank you and everybody for joining us tonight. And I want to thank Kay Hagan for her service. It's a tough job, and her and Chip are good people. We just have very different visions for America and very different ways to deal with President Obama and the Washington establishment. You know, I had a wonderful childhood, but it wasn't always easy. I've been a paper boy, a short order cook. And when I graduated from high school, I didn't go to college. I was working in a warehouse and living in a trailer park. In over 16 years in 5 different institutions, I finally received my degree. Along the way, I met my beautiful wife, Susan, and I had 2 wonderful children. I'm a living example of somebody who's realized the American dream. I want to go to Washington and make sure every single American has the same opportunity to realize their American dream. When Kay Hagan went to Washington, she immediately became a part of the Washington establishment, a rubber stamp for Barack Obama and Harry Reid. She's failed the people of North Carolina, and that's why I'm running for the U.S. Senate. When I went to Raleigh, I fulfilled my promises. I took on the Democratic and Republican establishments. I worked with them, I showed them respect, and over a few short years, they elected me as Speaker of the House. I want to bring that same leadership to Washington, and I want to make America great again. We live in the greatest nation on the face of this earth. We can return this nation to greatness. I'm Thom Tillis. I'm asking for your vote. Thank you. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you, Speaker Tillis. And we want to thank both Senator Kay Hagan and Speaker Thom Tillis for their participation. The candidates will participate in a second debate. That's on October 7th. This public service program was brought to you by the North Carolina Association of Broadcasters Educational Foundation. On behalf of all of us, thank you for watching, and don't forget to vote.